Welcome back to another edition of What's New in EDU, live from London at Bett UK. It's day two of the show, and as you can see, it's in full swing. There's so many more EdTech innovations to see, so let's jump right in, shall we? In yesterday's episode, we learned about some new, rugged, and affordable devices with features designed to make students' and teachers' lives easier. We also got to play with some of the amazing free tools within Office 365 that help students develop communication and collaboration skills. Those are skills every student needs to master, no matter the career or field they choose. But what about the jobs of the future, the ones we can only imagine? How do we equip our students with skills for jobs that don't exist yet? Well, I've been hearing from fellow educators on this very topic.
As a history teacher, I think it might be a little easier because we've gone through changes like this before. So we just sort of talk about how society adjusted to things like the Industrial Revolution and talk about how even though the jobs don't exist today, we can't really imagine what they'll be in the future, but we have to be ready for whatever society throws at us.
I think the challenge is just the unknowns. You don't know what skills will be necessary for them to master. And you prepare them by just trying to instill a love for learning so that no matter what they go into, they want to learn more about it and become better at it. And teaching them grit, determination, the ability to not give up when things get hard. I think those are important tasks to learn so that no matter what the job is, you keep going until it's finished.
Because of the changes that are going on, I think you have to combine critical thinking with creative thinking. You have to think critically about whatever comes your way, but you also have to be creative so that you can think about it in ways that it hasn't been thought about in the past and be able to face the future with new ideas and innovative ideas.
This week at Bett, Microsoft is proving that as educators, not only do we need to create learning experiences that prepare students for the future, we need those education experiences for ourselves as well. We need to be ready for the future too. Isn't that right, Chris?
Absolutely. We can't teach future-ready skills like STEM, computer science, unless we have our own set of tools and resources to create those learning experiences.
Okay, that sounds great. Chris here is an MIE and senior learning technologist who I've been getting to know this week. I'm really glad you're here to help me talk about the latest announcements from Microsoft. The updated and improved Microsoft Educator Center. So do you want to tell me a little bit about it?
Absolutely. So the Microsoft Educator Center has been so helpful to both myself and other educators I know. And if you're not familiar, it's a platform designed to address your specific needs as an educator.
Fantastic. For me, am I right in saying that you can get free content, training and support to help you use technology effectively to drive student outcomes?
100%. The MEC is a hub for innovative courses and resources built by teachers for teachers. That's what's so unique about it, Stephen. You can earn badges, go deep on topics, through learning pathways, build your transcripts, and grow your expertise. It helps you gain new skills and helps you bring technology into the classroom.
That sounds great. I mean, definitely it's great for creating inclusive and accessible environments and so much more. Me personally, it's been my go-to for professional development. I'm really proud about the badges I've collected, and I've got a chance to meet some really great educator friends just like you.
So the new MEC experience is available to check out right now at education.microsoft.com. I've only just scratched the surface myself, but I'm excited to dig in. And by sharpening my own skills, I can support other educators and our students. It's a win-win.
Hey, for me, that's great. All right, let's celebrate being prepared for the future with a selfie, because we're going to Minecraft later. So
absolutely.
On the count of three, let's say Minecraft. So we're going to do a 1, 2, 3, Minecraft. 1, 2, 3, Minecraft!
Thanks, guys. So I am so excited to be here with Melanie Mulligan from Northern Ireland, all the way from Belfast. Melanie, tell the folks about you.
Well, my name is Melanie Mulligan, and I am an education manager for the Council for Curriculum Examinations and Assessment in Belfast in Northern Ireland.
So we just went and filmed a new video with Melanie and her team in Belfast to show the world this amazing new Viking resource that they created for students across Ireland. And Melanie's going to tell us a little bit more about how this new Viking curriculum is helping students learn STEM across different subjects. So Melanie, tell us more.
So really, yes, the title is about the Vikings, and we chose that topic because a lot of schools do it.
Okay.
And we knew that we wanted to bring in the Minecraft Education Edition, which was potentially a new thing for teachers. So we chose a theme that teachers were very familiar with and would feel comfortable with, whilst bringing in this new pedagogy that maybe was a little bit more uncertain. And we produced three products, if you like, that create this package. We have a booklet that teachers are very familiar with called an ICL. It just stands for Ideas for Connecting Learning. Mm-hmm. And it provides loads of opportunities offline for teachers to do things around the history, the science, you know, asking big questions about the Vikings and finding out about the history of the mm-hmm. Vikings in Ireland. But within that, we have signposted opportunities for the teachers then to take the kids online into the bespoke Viking world that we've built. And the children then are challenged with these quests that we've provided to give purpose. So things like build your own Viking settlement based on all that learning that you've done offline, taking the skills and building and crafting in game.
And what's an example of how they're learning math and history or coding and engineering at the same time?
So, for example, they will have offline been learning about shipbuilding, about the Vikings and the designs that they would have used. They will have carried out some scientific investigations in the classroom, and then they'll have taken that knowledge and gone in to Minecraft and actually thought about what materials would have been available in Viking times. And then they will also be thinking about the design. So we're hearing kids coming out with things like the clinker-built design of the Viking ships and really making sure that they're authentically designed in line with, and obviously within Minecraft itself, the spatial ability skills that the kids are using in terms of directional language and navigating through the world, measuring area perimeters, working to scale, etc. There's just so much we could talk about it all day.
Yeah. That's wonderful. Well, check out the new video. It talks all about this new Viking resource and how the CCA team that Melanie is on created this for the schools in Belfast. For Bett this year, Minecraft Education Edition is really excited to release a new social emotional learning content pack. So this is a set of three different lessons themed around mindfulness, digital citizenship, and creativity that is set up to help teachers build those skills with their students. And so I'm gonna navigate through the new library. We have over 200 lessons available for educators to use already built into the game. And I'm gonna open up the new Mindful Night. So the Mindful Night is a really, really cool world that teaches different skills like self-awareness, self-regulation, sort of emotional understanding and mindfulness for young people. So Melanie, when we talk about social emotional learning and you've built this amazing kind of cross-curriculum resource, what kind of learning and sort of emotional awareness are you noticing in your students?
That's been one of the joys that we have encountered as we've been going along. Well-being is of interest to everyone, and certainly whenever we're developing resources, we want to make sure, especially games-based learning, we want to make sure that the children are enjoying it, and the happiness is so important. And the thing about happiness, the key to that is about building meaningful connections. And we're seeing children working collaboratively, blissfully together, not in competition with each other. They're in competition with the environment in Minecraft as opposed to each other. And we're seeing real lovely examples of that. And as well, because of the nature of the resource, it helps to, it's like an enabler, if you like, to foster intrinsic motivation. So the kids, they have the autonomy to build and design and use their imagination. They have the purpose, so they're in there, they're challenged, they're having that social connection, which I think all really builds towards some of those key issues.
Yeah, oh, that's fantastic. So the other update that we have, which you've probably heard of, is that we're now offering Python with Microsoft yes. MakeCode for Minecraft.
Brilliant.
And so students can use Code Builder to code in blocks, in JavaScript, and now in Python. So Python's, of course, really important to data science and some of these new future-ready skills. I'm wondering what you guys do with coding in Minecraft, if anything, CCA.
That's something that we have started to look at. We're just getting a new update to schools. It will be coming with the new, where it makes it much easier to use the different programming tools. And we've definitely been talking and buzzing with ideas. My colleague Julie and I are constantly thinking about, oh, we could do this and we could do that and we could do the other. And certainly we have found a number of teachers who've got in touch with us who are really into using the resource, who are coming together, and we're hoping that they're going to be leaders of this type of learning, and they can help us as well, you know, find out what they're doing and all the awesome stuff that's going on in schools.
So if teachers want to try coding in Minecraft, you can actually go to our website and try a new coding demo. Totally free. Anybody on a Windows, Mac, or iPad can do this free lesson, no login required. Check it out, and definitely make sure to check out Python and MakeCode.
Hi, I'm here with my good friend Ankur, and we're going to learn more about hacking STEM. Do you want to tell me a little bit about it?
Sure. Welcome, Stephen. Welcome to Hacking STEM.
Thank you. This is a cool place. I like it.
At Hacking STEM, our mission is to democratize and modernize STEM education. We are trying to modernize it by making it hands-on and making it affordable and adding four 21st century technical skills.
Okay.
They are mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, software engineering, and data science.
Got it.
So not changing what teachers are doing in the classroom, but adding these hands-on components to augment what teachers are doing.
Love that.
So modernizing current STEM curriculum.
Okay, good. I'm liking that.
We are trying to democratize STEM education by making it affordable, by using inexpensive objects that are easily available and affordable across the globe. We want to remove economic barriers from STEM education. We have had the honor of partnering with NASA recently. As you see here, we are celebrating 20 years of humans in space. We partnered with NASA to come up with a collection of 8 lesson plans, and they celebrate 3 different aspects of space travel, which are going to space, living in space, and coming back from space. Let me show you one of them.
Oh, please do. Yeah, let's go on over. Let's find out more. All right.
So this project here.
What am I doing? What am I seeing?
Yeah, this project here talks about astronauts living in space. And the name of the project is Protecting Astronauts' Feet in Microgravity. So astronauts face a unique problem in space. When they are floating around in microgravity, they use their feet to latch onto stuff. And they stabilize themselves by latching onto bars like this across the thing, not their hands. Because they have to use their hands in the space station. So you can take a look at that screen there. Yeah.
So all about their feet, okay.
Right, so they are using their feet to latch onto things.
Okay.
So the insight there is, when they come back from the space, the bottom of their feet are very smooth, but the top of their feet are blue. There's a lot of discomfort. So the challenge for students there is, one, to understand what's going on, and two, to potentially solve this problem.
Okay, excellent. How are we going to do that?
Let's do it.
Okay.
So
what am I looking at? What do I do?
So students start by building sensors to measure pressure on the feet.
Okay.
So as you can see, this is an array of sensors made out of some cardboard and copper tape.
Wow. Simple materials?
Simple materials. In market, these sensors cost about $20 a piece.
Okay.
But in the Hacking STEM world, these cost 20 cents a piece.
Wow. Okay.
So super affordable.
Yeah, excellent.
And you're able to use these sensors to stream real-time pressure data in Excel.
So
if you pressure one of these, put a pressure on one of these, and you'll see in Excel here, what the real-time data is. So once they build sensors, they do some basic experiments and replicate what astronauts do in space. So try putting this sock against this bar, like as if you're an astronaut and latching on, and let's see what happens. Where do you see the most pressure?
There on the metatarsals.
Metatarsals. So that's what students do. They try to figure out where the problem lies, and then the challenge for them is to solve this problem, which is, can you design a mitigation prototype to protect astronaut feet?
Okay, maybe I have an idea. I'm seeing something here. Tell me more though.
So think of how you could divide your classroom in groups of 5 or 6 students and give them a design challenge. And then students come up with designs.
Okay, cool.
Let me share with you one of the designs that students came up with.
Yeah. I keep this?
You can keep this.
Okay.
So this is, the students call this Astro Sock Slipper or Space Slipper.
Or Googly Eye Slipper.
Or Googly Eye Slipper. And it's made out of some cardboard, some flexible string.
It looks awesome.
And some pool noodle.
Okay.
So what they do is they put their sock inside.
Alrighty.
Do the same experiment again.
Okay, I got you.
And try to see how students have mitigated pressure or how successful their prototype is.
Okay. Much lower.
So as you can see, the pressure is much less.
Okay, I like this. Good design.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's a good one.
There is another one here.
Okay.
Maybe you can do it. This is a different design. What do you think about this design?
Not as visually appealing. You know, I like the googly eyes, definitely not. I like the spongy stuff going on there. But this does have, I think, one big advantage for me. This.
The latching mechanism. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm thinking so anyway. What are we doing here? Just
Students do the same thing. Yeah. But at the end of the day, it's the data that decides what's working well.
Excellent.
Right?
It's really nice. I'll have a go.
Yep. Take a look at it.
Okay. In you go. Oh, wow. Okay.
There we go.
And then we're just testing.
Yep.
What's the idea for the students? They're going to just test this sensor.
So once they have tested it, they are able to compare trials. So mitigation one was the googly-eyed, and two is the latching mechanism.
So which one will we choose there based on the two designs right now? What do you think?
I like the googly eyes.
Googly eyes, yeah, and the data supports the googly eyes?
Yeah.
Okay, I like that. Okay, perfect. So, yeah, very informative. I think I've learned a lot, to be honest with you. One thing I'd like to do, when I saw there, first of all, I was like, okay, well, I think we need to do a space selfie. What do you think about that?
Let's do it.
Okay, so let's go. So, 3, 2, 1. Hey, Jacqueline.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jacqueline Russell, and I'm the program manager on the Microsoft MakeCode team. Today, we're super excited. We've got two big news announcements we're making. The first is general availability of MakeCode Arcade, which is an online game development environment where students can code their very own arcade games and download them onto handheld game devices like this one. The second big piece of news is that we now support the Python programming language for MakeCode in Minecraft. And to talk a little bit more about that, I have a very good partner of ours from Prodigy Learning.
Hi, everyone. I'm Peter Doherty from Prodigy Learning. I am a global Minecraft mentor and trainer and the product manager for Coding in Minecraft product. Coding in Minecraft is a credential and curriculum program which immerses students in the fun and exciting world of Minecraft to learn coding using both block-based MakeCode and also text-based JavaScript. Today, I'm excited to announce that we will also be releasing a Python pathway in the coming weeks to coincide with this exciting release and news from Microsoft.
Great, thanks so much, Peter. And now on to you, Neil and Steven.
This is wonderful.
Steven.
Oh, hey.
Hey, how are you?
Hey, how are you?
I'm good.
Fancy you stopping by here.
Yeah, since you've already noticed speed up and slow down.
I just saw it.
How about I walk you through some of our other new features that we're shipping for Video Editor?
Please,
that be all right?
On you,
all
let's go.
Cool. So the first one I wanted to share with you is we've heard feedback from you and other educators that the students not only need to grab content from their computer, they also want to grab content off of the web.
Okay.
So we've added Add from Bing. I can go ahead and search for something like, let's say, astronaut.
Okay.
It's going to go ahead and show me all the pictures with the Creative Commons license.
Okay.
I can pick the one I want. I love this one that's out in the middle of outer space. Once it adds that into my collection, I'll show you in a second how I can drag that in.
Yeah.
So I'm going to drag this one in. And you can see up there, it gives me a Creative Commons license. What that allows me to do is have a good conversation with my students about what it means to responsibly use media, that we don't just pull things off the internet willy-nilly.
Yeah.
We want to make sure that we're responsible with that content when it doesn't belong to us.
It's a big deal in the classroom.
That's awesome. You want to see something else?
Oh, yep.
So here's the other one. We've had trim for a long time. You've been able to shorten up clips that way. But you haven't yet had the ability to split videos, and we've just added that in over the last few months.
Okay.
So if I open up a video clip right here, I can drag that in, decide where I want to cut that down, go ahead and hit done, and you can see down there on my storyboard, now I have two items there in place instead
nice
of one.
Pieces.
Yeah, and if it's still too long for you, continue to just feel like free and cut it down.
Okay.
Yep. But really, honestly, what I came here for, I have never been in one of your famous selfies, and I've been dying to be in one. Would that be okay?
You know me and selfies.
All right, let's
I'm not
do
shy
it.
About them. Let's go. All right. 1, 2, 3, Bett 2020! Well, that's a wrap on day 2 from the Bett floor. So much useful information about teacher training, bringing STEM resources into your classroom, and ideas for helping your students build future-ready skills. Make sure you join us tomorrow live from Bett, when we'll look closely at specific ways to foster inclusion and accessibility in the classroom with the help of new EdTech resources. Oh, I almost forgot. In case you haven't seen on social, we had an amazing event that kicked off Bett called FanFest. We got to connect with our educator community and try out the newest stuff happening at the Microsoft Store. I can't wait to show you more tomorrow. In the meantime, head on over to my Twitter page for a look behind the scenes at the wonderful time we had. As always, share your feedback with us on Twitter by tagging @MicrosoftEDU. I don't know about you, but I'm going to take a quick walk on the moon. One small step for man, wonderful leap for mankind. Let's go!